Now we will turn the floor over to Edgar Chamorro.
Last week I watched in TV the story told by himself, Mr. Elie Wiesel, or Wiesel, the man of the Holocaust, who have been writing so many books on that story. And he was very candid, you know, saying that after he went through the horror, he didn't want to talk at all about it until Mr. François Mauriac persuaded him, once he was a guest of him, and stayed with him and told him, he told the story that Mauriac is a Christian, a Catholic, and he was talking about Jesus Christ suffering so much and so on. He said, well, Mauriac back and forth with Jesus Christ suffering and Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ. So he said, finally, I have to give it back to him, you know, with this Jesus Christ suffering, you know, so much. So he told him that he thought that the Jewish people have suffered much more than Jesus Christ. And that, and Mauriac walked away and then finally stopped him and looked at him and says, if you feel like that, why don't you go out and talk about it? He says, that made him think that it's important to talk about things that we don't like to talk about. I tell you this story because I just watched this in TV and it impressed me, because it's very hard to go around talking about this. This is almost my fourth year. I am not doing too much, thanks God, this year, but the year of the Reagan trying to get $270 million, he tried to get the second time after the $100 million. So I was invited by many groups to go and talk. It's very hard, you know, because what I am finding very frustrating is that the more you talk, the more you get caught in this kind of, I don't know how you call it, you know, like a game plan, or it fits the other side, that, and we go nowhere, and the people in Nicaragua keep suffering. So every time I'm invited, this time I accept, of course, you know, a Bill Shapp and Ellen Reid in the Media Institute were the first people when I left the Contras that came to visit me, and they invited me to write my story. They thought it was important. For me, it was very painful to go, you know, living through that again, because you have to really go through your life, you know, and think, what did I do that? I mean, why I let these people use me? And what's wrong with me? I mean, after all, you know, because anytime you do something like that, you are questioning yourself, your character, your personality, your intelligence, your man of what, integrity or so on, or why you were so stupid or so a fool, you know. So it becomes a very painful, and I want to say that because I am going through that kind of crisis. You know, I don't even want to talk about it too much. But I think it's important, you know, at least once in a while. I accepted first to go to the World Court with an affidavit. I said, well, that will do it, you know. Nobody will ask me again, you know, because it's written there. Go and read my affidavit. Please don't want to talk about it. But no, the more, once you do something like that, the press come, there are good people writing good books, you know. There are like 20 books on the Contras and the way the United States have been deceived and so on out there. And I can see myself in many of those, not even quoted many times, but I am there. And sometimes full chapters, you know. But the real point I want to say is that once you go out to talk, then people come more, and then there are reporters, articles, people who are writing for history or for the media of TV and so on. And you know you are being used again, you know. And then I decided I'm going back to Nicaragua. Of course Nicaragua wants to use me too, you know. And I have a problem with this thing about using people. I think I am coming to a difficult problem with the instrumentalization of people. And I think it's a key element, at least in the extreme left, what I call the extreme left, the very radical, and the extreme right. I have been trying to find myself in the center, you know, what I don't know what is the center, because it's very relative, you know. When I was criticizing Reagan is so much to the right that I might be a radical leftist, you know, because he's so much to the right. He makes me look too much to the left, you know. Now they bring somebody, they call it a moderate, you know. Like, he could be more moderate, but what does it mean that, you know? also, you know, so I am finding that one of the problems is this instrumentalization of people. That's why for me it's very hard to keep talking, and because I think the one of the elements we have to understand about CIA, and I believe also of some of the extreme governments that we call of the left radical, is this concept of man that is to be used. You know? I have seen many movements of the left using people, and movements of the right, and so on. So I say that because, you know, I am going through that particular crisis. I am in the not really seeing the usefulness, but I think, okay, I wanted to start with those words of Mr. Elie Wiesel, that it's important to talk because of the horror, you know, the horror. And I think that intellectuals, academics, analysts like to make things in abstracts. And I myself, you know, I have here, you know, a very abstract outline, you know, and but the problem is how to translate to you the pain of being used, because I think it's important. For me, the most revulsive thing I felt when I accepted money from the CIA, that I guess that's what makes you a recruited person once you accept money. First, you know, I felt I was not recruited, that the CIA was working for me, you know, because my ego, my personality says, no, I mean, the United States, we can use them to go back to power. It's a Nicaraguan power struggle. The Chamorros want to go back to power. My group, my aristocratic group, my elite group, my whatever, you know, we want to go back to power and we'll use the United States. And there is some of that also. So I say, well, we'll use them, and, but you really find out that you're not using them. They're just using you. Because in any moment that you want to have an influence in the movement or to be independent, you are cut off from meetings, or from money, or from whatever, you know? Or just they make you believe that you are somebody and you are not. They still flatter you, that they need you, they need your face, they need your name, they need your to be a victim, maybe, you know? Or to be a martyr, you know, but they need you. I want to jump to another experience that was very painful for me and was what made me leave, really, when I had to work with this CIA case officer who brought the manual on psychological operation. I believe it's a very important book to read for Americans if they want to understand what is the CIA all about. That little book called The Manual on Psych Ops, you know, is totally not anti-communist. It's a communist in the purest sense of the word, manual, where all the techniques or all the tactics or whatever expertise that have been accumulated, you know, to force people, to recruit people, to embarrass people, to humiliate people, to martyrize people, to victimize people, are there. So, you know, that compendium, you know, of these tactics was brought by the CIA to me. And I was responsible because I was the PR man, and at the same time, I was in charge of the political education. And the need for a political education came that the Contras were being trained by Argentinians, who were, I mean, from the military junta of Argentina, I mean, you know, a very fascist group, really, who had a very, you know, simplistic approach to things. So very brutal and very cruel. And in some discussion, I have been, you know, visiting Contras and talking to the soldiers being trained, and I asked them, why do you fight? If I ask you, you know, why do you come here? I mean, so they didn't know why they were fighting. I said, but what would you tell people once you take Ocotal? I mean, you are in Ocotal, you finish shooting people, there are a few survivors. You know, there is a woman there, a man there, a child. What do you tell them? you victorious Contra, you walk into Ocotal, what is your line? Not a word. I mean, these people were just trained to kill, you know, to destroy, to damage. But you say, but the Sandinista, I tried to defend you. I remember the Sandinista from school. I mean, they were full of ideas. They could write papers. They were using ditos. They didn't get any money, but they were people who had a lot of ideas in their heads. I mean, a lot of ideas and paper writing and talking to people and grassroots everywhere, grassroots. And, okay. But the Contras don't have anything. Do you have a political platform? Do you have a plan? Have you ever heard a Contra leader talking about political education, about schools once they take over? Have you heard of a Contra leader with an idea? So I said, you know, what? I mean, I was embarrassed in the CIK's office. I said, why do you do? We need it. So I heard that the idea went as far as Washington, and Jim Kilpatrick, and so on. They said, you know, we need to give them a little book, you know. So the guideline. We have made the joke, you know, we need like Mao Red Book or Gaddafi Green Book. We need what I call at that time a Blue Book. And I started working on my own little Blue Book that in some places is there. But the tragedy of that was that they sent us this black book called the Psychological Operations Manual, something taken from Four Bracks, you know the story. So it's very important, I am saying, for you people to read that and see that that book is about instrumentalization. Brutal, simplistic instrumentalization where you create martyrs, you assassinate judges, you selectively, of course, you know, no random killing. You know, the great advance in education in the United States is from random killing to selective killing, you know. So that those are the qualitative changes, you know, that make difference between deterministic societies, materialistic society, and democratic societies, where there is a higher degree of sophistication becomes an art, you know, scientific, selective assassination. They don't go killing around El Salvador or Guatemala. They selectively choose who should be killed. And the same was going on in Nicaragua. So, you know, maybe I waited too long, of course, you know, but that book for me was too much, you know, and that's when I gave the interview to the press and I went public with that and so on. So that obviously forced me out because so for me that's an important theme. I am glad in the latest book by Hollis Clara, I noticed she gave importance to that. I think it's important because I was telling an American case officer that came after they fired the first one that gave us that book, and then he says, well, he says, there was nothing wrong with the book. What's wrong is that they printed it. He says, you do those things, you don't write them down, you know. You know, CIA is about deniability, you know. You deny. So that's another thing, you know. People who are ready to deny are people who come to the situation to lie to you. I mean, it's a premeditated lie, everything. So if I go to follow my outline, I'll have to go here, and you can read, I have a book, thanks to Bill, that invited me to write it, called The Packaging of the Contrast. He asked me, because the Institute of Media Analysis, just to concentrate on that aspect. I didn't go to the war aspect or to other terroristic aspects, but just to the disinformation aspect. It's very important because I want to say that it's a big lie. If I want to use a word to describe what all this Contra, what all Reagan rhetoric or the administration rhetoric and so on, is just a big deception and lie, you know, it's just false. It's just more than false, it's premeditated, calculated lie for Congress, for the press, for the American people. But it's not, of course, why we talk about this here? Because the only reason why they do this is because it must be done, because you Americans don't know that communists are coming, that, you know, they're being Hallinger texts and so on, and we, the few chosen ones, are going to protect you, save your children, save, you know, and then they talk about drugs coming and so on. But it's quite the contrary. Is the contrast the one who are bringing, you know, the communist book, you know, to Central America. So that for me is very important to see the tragedy of all this misuse of words, instrumentalization, real criminal mentality, you know, where if you stay in something like that, you have to be insane or a total, you know, sarcastic or incredulous person. So I really will question the ethical standards or morality of anybody that can digest, you know, those operations. And still speak, you know, like man of good faith to the American people. I believe that the moral question, the ethical question is very strong. It hasn't been raised enough. I don't have too much time because we can have more discussion. And Bill insisted because you want to read, you know, I have all this thing written. And I think it's important to write them down when you come to say those. So I am insisting on this concept of a big lie, how the Contras were instrumentalized to lie to Congress, lie to the press. Things just created, fabrication of events, premeditated, you know, to influence Congress or the press. Or when, like sometimes they say, you know, this is not for the American people, this is just for the press, you know. So, I mean, I don't know how press people respect themselves, you know, but they are being used constantly. I guess they have to run, you know, and they are flooded with information or whatever the other man said, you know, and then they have to print or make a living or so on. But it's very little questioning going on this matter. But I think that we come down to a big moral question and ethical point. I have other methodological aspect I would like to discuss because the methodology of this horror or lie is in the permanent looking for ways to harm people who are they don't even know what is hitting them, you know. So that it's called in the phraseology now in use low-intensity wars or low-intensity conflicts. But basically are psychological wars that are very cleverly, you know, oriented to use people to lie, and then very cruel to the recipient, because there is cruelty in not only in rapes or in assassinations, in destruction of the economy, in making people suffer from lack of electricity and water and so. And there is another item you have to keep in mind, that this is just part of a big iceberg going on, because when we talk about the contrast, we are talking about the external pressure in Nicaragua. What about the budget of the CIA inside Nicaragua? Who is investigating that? Who is talking about that? I mean, it has been going on for years and nobody talks about it. Like, if the only attack to Nicaragua comes from outside, from the contrast, that could be even the tip of the iceberg. I mean, the real weight against Nicaragua is inside. When I went to Nicaragua in October, I started watching and looking and going around. You know, once you have seen the thing from inside, you can see more. So I went in October 87, stayed 8 months, and then I came back for the whole, you know, against the package that Reagan wanted and so on in 88. So that vote at least was good, you know, it was defeated the 8 in February 3rd or 4th, 88. And then I went back to Nicaragua April, and then also in the summer. What I have seen is that slowly there have been a from Contra activity that still is there, you know, there's still their attacks and so on, and they still have weapons. So there is a shift, you know, to put more pressure inside against the economy, with the political parties, with the church, with the press. You know, there are more than 76, according to a professor from Ohio University, and there are so many articles. I mean, you can just, you know, see that there is so much. 76 radio stations in Nicaragua, you know, broadcasting and so on. And on top of that, a constant disinformation, so people will repeat those slogans and so on.
So, can you repeat that 76? There are more than 76 what?
Radio stations broadcasting against Nicaragua, so people will believe not only, you know, that the Sandinistas commit abuses or human rights, but, you know, there is, CIA is very clever. Sometimes what they wanted to produce in Nicaragua was make people leave the country. You know, these people rarely say, we don't want the brown food people coming down here. But the CIA is doing everything possible in Nicaragua so that people will be scared and in a stampede leave Nicaragua. Because then they can say, you know, those totalitarian communist Sandinistas are so bad that people are leaving by the thousands. But that's done on purpose. No, that through, you know, a campaign, you know. So, well, we can go into all this, you know, because this, it takes, I guess, all the, you know, brain of some, you know, very distorted brains of some kind of, thinking, you know, what to do wrong there. But I want to finish with that the problem have been inside the country, and we haven't analyzed that enough, I think. There have been a lot of damage to the structure of Nicaragua, infrastructure, to the economy, and to people, and so on. So I'll be, thank you for.
Are the floor mics live? If they are, it might make it easier for people with questions to come down to the mics, and I'll go back and forth in order. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question for Mr. Agee, and it has to do with the fight against drugs and the use of drug enforcement activity throughout the hemisphere and actually throughout the world. And I wanted some input from you of whether there's a possibility that if the dimension of anti-communism becomes less of a rationale, that a drug war, a concerted international drug war, could become another rationale, another effective rationale. And I also wonder if you might comment, because this has mystified me, what has happened in Panama with the drug
scene. Yes, well, you know, at the beginning of the 80s, the emphasis wasn't as much on anti-communism, or let's say there was another factor there to justify activities, which was anti-terrorism, and that anti-drug campaigns now is used to justify repressive or militarization in different places. I've always asked myself the question, or I haven't always, but I do now. I ask myself the question, is it really impossible for the United States, with all its technology, all of its military and police power, is it really impossible to impede the inflow, or stop the inflow of drugs into the United States? Is there some political dividend or benefit in the fact that thousands upon thousands, if not millions, of ghetto youths who are potential political activists, who have everything to gain by radical change in this country, are taken out of the political scene when they go on crack, go on cocaine, go on heroin? I can't prove. Of course they did. And you see, the CIA has been in this drug scene from the very beginning as well. All of these things that we see today go right back to the very beginning. You know, when Mao defeated the Chinese nationalists, a whole division or army, 10,000 people, found refuge in the hills of Burma just across the border. And they were supplied for years by the CIA, resupplied, kept operating as a unit. They were going to be a liberation army, something like the Contras are today. And they kept going, but it turns out that early on, they got much better at raising poppies and creating opium than they were at fighting the communist forces in China. And that was the beginning of the Golden Triangle, which continued on into the years of U.S. intervention in Southeast Asia. Also very early on, in the late 40s, the CIA gets involved with the Corsican Mafia, who controlled and ran the heroin processing laboratories around Marseille, what became later known as the French Connection. The CIA got involved with the Corsican Mafia to break strikes on the docks of Marseille when the communist unions in France refused to unload martial aid. This is late 40s. And so the CIA called on this Corsican mafia to bring in strong-arm bullies, and it left strikers dead and injured. The strikes were broken. But that relationship with the Corsican mafia continued all through the years. Well, it goes around the world, and the latest is, of course, Colombia. I don't know how many people know that, in fact, it seems that few people know, that the diversion of profits from the arms sales to Iran to the Contras had a very specific purpose in replacing an ongoing Contra resupply operation known as the arms supermarket, which everyone concerned, North, Casey, and others, were afraid was about to blow sky high because it was financed with drug money from Colombia. This thing starts about 1983, when it was clear that Congress was going to cut off the funding for the Contras, at least the military funding, which they did. But Casey, North, and the others turned to the Israelis to find a solution to the problem. They found it in the Israelis. The Israelis organized this new resupply operation to replace that which had been funded by the Congress of the United States, and it was financed with drug money. The key figure is a man named Ramon Millan Rodriguez, a man who way back years ago, I think his history goes back to the Bay of Pigs with the CIA, Cuban-American, trained by the CIA in money laundering. That means passing it through different accounts to conceal the original source. He puts these talents at the service of the cocaine cartel and launders hundreds of millions of dollars, probably billions of dollars, through Panamanian banks, Panama, including branches of the Citibank and the Bank of America. In late 1983, he delivers $10 million in cash for the commencement of this armed supermarket operation. He delivers the money in cash to another Cuban-American whose history goes back to the beginning, Felix Rodriguez, who is operating out of Ilopango Air Base in El Salvador. When Eugene Hassenfuss is shot down over Nicaragua in October 1986, Felix Rodriguez, who dispatched him from Ilopango on that flight, makes the first cry of alarm to the vice president's office. The telephone records show it. Telephone records also show that there was constant contact between Felix Rodriguez and Bush's office, principally in the figures of Donald Gregg, his national security advisor, and Samuel Watson, a colonel who is another national security advisor. Well, all this is happening through Panama because the cocaine cartel in Colombia has these aircraft that are bringing cocaine to the United States to military bases where it goes out. They're loading up with arms to go back to Central America. Noriega is giving transit privileges through Panama for these flights. And, of course, the money is coming through Panama also to finance the thing coming from the cocaine cartel. And Felix Rodriguez even comes up to Washington and, according to the notes of Bush's appointment secretary, briefs the vice president on the arms resupply operation. In 1975, the Justice Department conducted an investigation of the Drug Enforcement Agency, the DEA, for corruption. The results of that investigation come out in a report completed in June 1975, known as the DeFeo Report, after the attorney in the Justice Department who made the investigation, who coordinated it. Before the year is out, this DeFeo Report is over to CIA. At that time, Noriega is a very important liaison contact with the CIA because of his position as chief of the Panamanian Intelligence Service, that is the Intelligence Service of the Panamanian Defense Forces. And the CIA had large bases there at the time. They had important operations going out of Panama, and it was very important to keep good relations going with Noriega so there would be no interference in these operations. Well, Bush comes in as director of the CIA in January of 1976, after the CIA already has this DeFeo report, which, by the way, I forgot to say, showed that that Noriega was up to his neck in drug dealing. This is 1975, the reports of the CIA. Bush comes in as director in January 1976, and in the course of that year as CIA director, he meets Noriega at least on one occasion, I don't know how many. When the director meets a foreign intelligence chief of importance like Noriega, he is briefed totally on the background with this person. I mean, if the CIA didn't know before the DeFeo report that Noriega was in drug dealing, and they had to because they knew what was happening in Panama, they certainly did from the DeFeo report. And so that would have been a part of the briefing, because the briefing includes the history of the agency's relationship with this person, how much money the agency is paying him. I've read $200,000 to $250,000 a year to Noriega at that time. What the problems have been, what the joint operations between the two services are, all those details before he meets the chief of the foreign service. Reagan is asking us to believe that he knew nothing of Noriega's drug connections until the indictment this past February. He's asking us therein to believe that the world is flat, in my estimation. Well,
my question concerns corruption of the CIA and its officers and agents in the recent years. Can you hear me? I'm not sure if this microphone is on. It's obvious from what you both said and written that you both are men of very high ideological principles, and that your motivation in joining the CIA or working for it were admirable at the time. At least, perhaps you can say you worked from ignorance, but at least you were not simply opportunists. You were not simply paid to perform criminal acts. It seems to me that is less and less possible. With all that has come out in the last 20 years. And I would like to ask you both, do you feel that the CIA today has a corruption problem, that it is internally, that it is becoming more and more of a criminal activity?
Well, you know, but I will be extremely harsh, you know, with the philosophy, with the concept of the agency as such, you know, just on the design, you know, because by definition, by design, is a left hand covert, secret, no debate, no, they can do anything they want, they are accountable, we don't know to whom, you know, even the highest authority in the country said he didn't know. So who is the boss? Who, we don't know. You know, we are in the Kafka world, you know, who is in the castle? We don't know, because the president said he didn't know. And the next guy says the buck stops here, but didn't say anything with that, because he just avoided it. So for me, it's extremely serious that the democracy needs a CIA. Because, I mean, the United States, you know, goes around the world. I come from Nicaragua, and I used to believe a lot in the United States. For me, this experience, as sad as it is, it's a big lesson in life, you know. You have two sides also to reconcile. You have a very dark side. I don't know the Soviet Union or the worst Stalin period or the Nazi era, but I know the dark side of America, and it's pretty dark.